So I've been content with that ever since. Not totally happy because I'd like to get this mess over with very quickly, folks. But there are people that are being won to God every day on this earth. And he has plans to show every one of us what the truth is so that we can decide whether we love the truth, we love God for what he's done for us, and we will be loyal to him, or whether we don't care. We'd rather have a good time. We'd rather, you know, go around doing things that will destroy us and will have a bad influence on others and help them be destroyed. I think most of you know the rest of the story. I'll quote a scripture text for you. In Matthew chapter 27, and it's not on there, verses 50 through 51, it's talking about the crucifixion. It says, when he had cried again, he died. The veil of the temple was torn in half from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were rent. When I found the cross hole, I found a crack right along to the left side of it. When I saw this, I thought, okay, that proves that what was recorded in Matthew is accurate. The earth had cracked there, but I had no idea of why. The Ark of the Covenant, after all of this traveling around I had done through this cave, was exactly 20 feet below where the crosshole was. And it was solid limestone between the two. And I suppose Satan was quite happy. He probably knew the blood of Christ was going to have to get on the mercy seat. He knows Scripture a lot better than we did. And he was probably pretty happy. It can't get through 20 feet of solid limestone. When that crack opened up, and the centurion stuck his spear in Christ's spleen and probably the left ventricle of the heart. And all the blood and water, which was the platelets and the serum, blood is a mixture that has to be constantly in motion, otherwise it separates out into serum and platelets. So when Christ died, the separation process began. Very shortly thereafter, the platelets clot and would be a big rubbery clump that would not have come out through a spear wound. So everything had to be timed perfectly. So the blood of Christ gushed out, went down through there, ratifying the old covenant and the new covenant as proof that God had accepted Christ's sacrifice. When Christ came out of his grave, it says many of the saints that were asleep, when he awoke, they awoke and went into the holy city. So we have been bought with a price, folks. And if we neglect what God has done for us, that's the most horrible thing that can happen to anybody. Have you ever been in a situation where you thought you were too late for something real important to you or to somebody else? You know, I was supposed to meet somebody here. I got hung up in traffic, didn't make it. And, you know, one of those kinds of feelings of it being too late. God is offering every one of us salvation today. We don't have any guarantees that it will still be there for tomorrow. Okay? Now, I don't believe in trying to scare people, folks. Christ died for you, the Son of God. Paid for us with his blood just a few feet from here. Offering every one of us salvation today. We don't have any guarantees that it will still be there for tomorrow. Okay? Now, I don't believe in trying to scare people, folks. Christ died for you, the Son of God.
Yes, he's good for that good son.
Paid for us with his blood just a few feet from here. was. Now, when I found this, there was no sign of any water had fallen in afterwards. And with a crack right above it, surface water, dirt, and stuff would be expected to have fallen in. And I wondered what happened. I had people ask me. And so I got to thinking about that. Well, Sunday morning, when the angel came down to roll back the stone so Christ could come out of the tomb, it said there was a mighty earthquake. Right? I believe God closed the crack at that point. When we were there, the crack was only wide enough that by taking the tip off of a steel measuring tape, I was able to pass it through to make sure that the crack by the cross hole was the same one that came out over the mercy seat. We have to be thorough when we're doing God's work. We cannot be slipshod. Okay? So anyway, that is where Christ bought and paid for us, redeemed this planet from a usurper. Now, if you'll take the paper I gave you, I'd like to share something else with you. And I'll go through this quickly. You can read these verses at your leisure. Abraham was directed by God to come to a place in the mountains of Moriah to offer his son Isaac as a sacrifice. And it said, in a place that God had chosen. Right? You remember that Isaac, when they left the servants behind and they had the wood and everything, he told his dad, he says, we have everything here but a lamb. Where can we get a lamb? They were out in the boonies. And Abraham probably didn't realize it. But he's made a prophetic statement there. He said, God will provide it. Himself a lamb. The offering. I believe that was the same place that Christ was crucified. And as we move on through here, we find that Jacob passed this way. And he had a dream, and he saw heaven open and a ladder between heaven and earth, and angels coming and going, and he saw Christ at the head of the stairs. And he said, this is none but the gateway to heaven. This was a prophetic utterance, also directed by the Holy Spirit. Accurate, absolutely accurate. Now, he was just north of Jerusalem. If you're seeing something and it's straight above you, you don't get a very good view of it. You know, everything's just coming in your face. I believe that he looked at the reality. I doubt that angels use stairs or steps or ladders. But he said, this is the gate to heaven. Okay? Now, when they built the, in the other places here, God's chosen dwelling place is this city. It's here. The Temple Mount. All right? Now, God knew that the Jews were going to rebel. He knew all of that all the time. Something that you might want to do when you get home, read Ezekiel. Start at chapter 29 and go through there. It's quite enlightening. God said of the priests, because they have polluted themselves among the heathen and have defiled my place by bringing these people into my temple. He said, they will no more come near my holy things in my most holy place. Right? But he said, they shall offer the blood and the fat at my table. excuse me, if you read those chapters, you will find that the Israelites were directed to build a chest. It gives the size, all of that, and it says, and it shall be called the table of the Lord. In the second temple, in the most holy place, was this table. Titus carried it off with the candlesticks and all of that. In the first couple of chapters of Ezra, it tells us that when some of the ancient men and some of the priests that had lived through the whole captivity and were back here, it says when they saw the foundation of the second house, after having seen the first one, it says they wept. Right? This means that those priests, some of them had officiated in the holy place and knew what the table of showbread looked like. They knew what the candlesticks looked like. They knew what the golden altar of incense looked like. But there was nobody there that knew what the Ark of the Covenant looked like, because the high priest was dead. Right? So anyway, they made replicas of what had been in the holy place. But they were instructed to build this table of the Lord for the most holy place. Now, God directed that the Ark of the Covenant and all of the furnishings of the first temple and the wilderness tabernacle should be put in a cave chamber that's 12 feet wide, 22 feet long, and approximate average of 18 feet high. That is God's holy things, and that is His most holy place, because the Ark of the Covenant with the mercy seat that was the earthly throne of God, where it was placed, was called the most holy place. So there is the most holy place to this day. And it's where the blood of Jesus that fulfilled all of the types and shadows of the sanctuary service rests today. Now, we shared the 1 John chapter 5, verses 7, 8, and 9 with you on the bus. Remember that? There are three that keep record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. These three are one. There are three that bear witness in the earth: the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one. If we receive the witness of man, the witness of God is greater. And this is God's witness and testimony of His Son. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5 and 6, there's one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave Himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time. Folks, that's the place. And what the Bible tells us is that this is God the Father's proof to a lost world that they have been redeemed by the blood of His Son. Right? That is the Father's proof. When people have seen this and become aware of this, if they reject that, there's nothing else to follow. That is the heart and soul of the plan of salvation. And He has told us, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. In other words, it don't matter what we've done in the past. It doesn't matter how weak and sinful our natures are. Christ made provision for all of that when He died for us. All we have to do is go to the Father in the name and blood of the Son and ask for forgiveness and rehabilitation so we become Christ-like, and we will be ready at His coming. And folks, when the Holy Spirit sets up housekeeping in our hearts, we will develop a love for lost souls that will constrain us to do those things which are very inconvenient, time-consuming, expensive, and all of that. And that is working for lost souls. And when Christ comes, instead of fleeing and trying to hide from the face of Him that sits on the throne, we'll look up and say, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for Him." And He our choice to pay for it. Now, let's get back to this, what I'm saying here.